So, in other stupid news, apparently there's now a boycott being launched against Starbucks. So why is this Starbucks boycott being launched? Well, because there was a tape that came out in Philadelphia of two black men who were apparently arrested. This is a clip 8. Two black men being arrested because they were supposedly asked to use the restroom. And they were told that they could not, or they were hanging around the, I think it was that they were hanging around the Starbucks for like 15 minutes waiting for a friend to arrive. And the manager called the cops on them. Here's the tape of it. And then they took these two guys away. The guys were later released, and Starbucks has apologized for the entire incident. The boycott Starbucks hashtag has been trending on Twitter. Apparently, there are a lot of people who are legitimately going in and just yelling at people on at Starbucks. Like they're just going into Starbucks and yelling at the baristas at Starbucks, which is completely useless. The men were accused of trespassing. They said they were simply waiting for a friend before ordering. The video shot by customers is very hard to watch. The actions in it are not representative of our Starbucks mission and values, said the CEO of Starbucks. He said the basis for the call to the Philadelphia Police Department was wrong. Philadelphia's police commissioner on Saturday defended the arrest, saying his officers had to act after Starbucks employees told them the pair were trespassing. It's not the police's fault, right? The police come and they're told somebody's trespassing on private property. They have to make the arrest. I mean, they can't sit around and quibble over who made the call, why the call was made. They initially make the arrest if the people refuse to leave. These guys apparently refused to leave. Philadelphia's police commissioner said, of course, that they were asked to leave and that they did not. In a video statement, the police commissioner, Richard Ross, said store employees called 911 to report a disturbance and trespassing. When officers arrived, Ross said, staff told them the two men had wanted to use the restroom, but were informed it was only for paying customers. The pair reputedly refused to leave when politely asked to do so by employees and officers, he said. If you think about it logically, that if a business calls and they say someone is here that I no longer wish to be in my business, the officers now have a legal obligation to carry out their duties, and they did just that, said Ross. They're professional in all their dealings with these gentlemen, and instead they got the opposite back. And then Ross, who, by the way, is black, said he was acutely aware of implicit bias. He said, we are committed to fair and unbiased policing. Anything less than that will not be tolerated in this department. The two men were released after Starbucks said they were no longer interested in prosecuting them. Starbucks, of course, apologized for all this. And now they are pledging that they are going to give all of their baristas sensitivity training, implicit bias training. First of all, implicit bias training is completely useless. Okay, the studies on implicit bias training demonstrate that implicit bias itself is not a good gauge. Implicit bias, for those who don't know, if you've been in college recently, I'm sure you've taken this test. An implicit bias test is you sit at a computer and they show you a series of faces, black faces and white faces. And then they show you on the other side of the screen a series of words, good, bad, angry, smart. And then they see how fast you click the button to see, to associate the two, the words in the image. So if you are slower to identify smart and black and smart and than you are for smart and white, this means you are implicitly biased. The problem with IATs, implicit bias assessment tests, is that they're not statistically significant, meaning that you can they're not repeatable. I can take the test twice and get two completely different scores. You can train for the test. And there is no evidence whatsoever that so-called implicit bias in this way actually factors into real-world decision-making. So the even the people who created the implicit bias test will acknowledge that there is no hard evidence that even if you fail an implicit bias test, this means that you are a racist in your behavior and your dealings. And yet now we're going to do implicit bias retraining. It's just stupid over at Starbucks. Also, one of the problems that I have with some of the tapes that are being released, that wasn't the only tape that was released. There was another tape that was also released, this one from today, in which a black man was at a Starbucks in Los Angeles, and he claims that this is on Hawthorne. Okay, so let it be known that the area around Hawthorne is heavily minority. Okay, this Starbucks is in a very heavily minority area, so I really doubt that the manager at this particular Starbucks has never seen a black person in her establishment before. What you're going to see in this tape is that the guy who's taping tapes a white guy coming out of the restroom, and then he asks the white guy coming out of the restroom if the guy was asked to buy anything by the manager. And then he goes to the manager and he says, well, I wasn't allowed to use the restroom if I hadn't bought anything. And the lady says, I'm going to ask you to leave. And the guy refuses to leave. This guy posted the tape, and then he suggests that the Starbucks manager, who, by the way, is Asian, is a racist. So here is what that sounds like.
So I would like Starbucks right here on Redondo, on Artesia, and Hawthorne. This man right here said he hasn't made a purchase yet. He's in line to make a purchase, and you guys gave him the code. Right? Isn't that what you did? No, this is not your business. This is not your business.
This is not your business, though.
Okay, you may be a store manager, but you're not in charge. I'm not allowed to be in here anymore. Why? You see, they're so mad. Why are they upset with me, Weston? What did I do? I just tried to use a bathroom like you did, and they gave it to you. Is it my skin color? I can use the bathroom, but Weston could.
Amen.
I feel it may be my skin color. Hey, but this is about to be on social media. It's about to go in the shade room.
Okay, so Sean King posted this, the columnist for the New York Daily News, and he suggested, of course, that this is just demonstration of more implicit racism on the part of employees at places like Starbucks. And here's my problem with tapes like this. We don't have the whole tape. Okay, we don't know what happened in the 10 minutes prior to the tape. All we know is this guy walks up to the manager, and then he suggests that he's not being allowed to use the bathroom because she's a racist. At one point, she starts to say, no, I'm actually asking you to leave because, and then he cuts her off. So how are we supposed to know why the manager did this? You know, we don't know what happened in this original store in Philadelphia. And there are a couple of witnesses you see on that tape that there's a white guy who says these black guys weren't doing anything, but we don't know when he came in. We haven't heard from the manager. We don't know what the manager had to say about the situation. Again, Philadelphia is a very heavily black town, so I can't imagine that Starbucks has never had black patrons before. I can't imagine that blacks are barred from the Starbucks over there. All I'm asking is, I'm suggesting that we may not know the whole story here. Maybe we do know the whole story. If we do know the whole story, then the employee should be fired, right? But if we don't know the whole story, then why are we jumping to the conclusion that Starbucks employees are essentially racist, especially in areas where they're dealing with black folks all the time? Is it possible that the people in Philadelphia sat down at the table and asked to use the bathroom, and then when they were told they could not until they bought something, they just refused to leave and they just stayed there? Is it possible that they're acting threatening toward the manager? I don't know any of this, right? It's all speculation. It's possible that everything I'm saying right now is completely incorrect, but you don't know either. And neither does anybody else. The media don't know. Presumably the manager knows. Presumably the people who were involved in the incident know, but we haven't heard from the manager. We still haven't heard a defense from the manager of exactly what happened inside that Starbucks. And now we're going to retrain thousands of employees across the country, including black employees across the country, in implicit bias without knowing the whole story. This is one of the things that just drives me up a wall. If you're going to suggest that there is implicit bias, if there's some sort of evil racism rampant throughout American society, at least give me the whole story. At least I have to have the whole tape. There are racists, okay? And we've shown some of those racists over the past couple of years on this program doing overtly racist things, and we have called them out on it. But if I don't know the whole story, am I going to jump to the conclusion that this guy's telling the truth? That conveniently, the very day after a national controversy involving a black man not being able to go to the bathroom in a Starbucks, another manager across the country on the other side of the country did the exact same thing to a black man. So I think that that's a little convenient for the narrative. I think it's a little convenient for the narrative. I don't think this is a massive widespread problem all across the country. And by the way, when my kids have to go to the bathroom at Starbucks, I buy something at Starbucks. And if they asked me to leave a restaurant, I would leave a restaurant. But again, I think people are apt to jump to conclusions that please them most rather than waiting for all the facts. As I say, if the testimony of these folks is true, then the person should be fired. You called the cops on someone for no reason, you should lose your job. However, I want to know the entire story. And this is, again, one of my pet peeves, is people using selective evidence to back the idea that America is systemically racist or systemically sexist.
By the language of uprising applied to people who are breaking into other black people's stores and looting them. This is a lack of values. And people who are destroying private property, destroying cop cars, in an uprising against what exactly? Against the black police chief, against a mostly minority police force, against the black mayor, against the black president, against the black attorney general, against the entirely, against a city council that is 9 of 15 are black and all 15 are elected Democrats. What is the uprising against? What is it seeking to achieve? I still don't see what exactly the riots are seeking to achieve. Bottom line is, this is all... It all could be boiled down to just act like a mensch. Act like a human being. Honestly, it's not useful to riot, it's not useful to break things, it's not useful to throw rocks at people. And the idea that we're supposed to sort of correlate
let's
your level
off
of
on
outrage.
The idea. I'm gonna stick to the 30 seconds on
yeah,
this
the last
one.
Sentence. The last sentence. Yeah. The idea that we're supposed to correlate your level of outrage with a certain level of justification, in other words, the more outraged you are and the more angry you are, the more justified you must be, is absolute nonsense.
How can you argue that racism is not a driving factor in income inequality?
because it has nothing to do with race and everything to do with culture. And when you have a culture that doesn't... You know what? Explain to me. You explain to me why black kids aren't graduating high school. Explain that one to me. Explain to me why black kids are shooting each other in rates significantly higher than whites are shooting each other. Explain to me why 13% of the population is responsible for 50% of the murder. Explain to me why the number of blacks and black kids in prison, not for innocent reasons, not for walking down the street and getting pulled into a prison, is so high. Explain, if it has nothing to do with culture, explain to me why the single motherhood rate in the black community jumped from 20% to 70% in the same course of time that the civil rights movement has made such tremendous strides. Is America more racist now than it was in 1960? And if it is, please explain to me how that happened.
Anybody well, can jump in. It's an open mic there.
But there has to be racism. You can't say there's no racism.
Without evidence?
No. I'm just saying that I don't know which animal. Maybe we're talking
about
dogs
racist.
Or something. I'm talking about human beings. And I'm like, human beings are most likely going to have racial prejudices. I'm just so sorry. I'm just so sorry. I don't know. I come from planet Earth.
Charles, I want to ask you a question. So your default is that when there is no evidence, racism is the deciding factor. That is
No, I was not saying that. I'm just saying that, that you're going to have sexist, you're going to have racist, you're going to have all this stuff. I mean, I'm just saying that...
I agree it exists, but the problem that I'm seeing, and this is the problem with the general conversation, is that there's no solution in simply saying there's racism out there. How does that solve anything? I mean, when you talk about there's institutional racism, what does that mean? Show me a law that is racist in intent, and we will agree. Show me a police officer who commits a racist act like we saw in South Carolina, right, where a police officer shot a black man running away and it was obviously unjustified, and I will agree. But you need, the idea that you can craft a narrative based on no racism because it just must be somewhere out there in the ether, that doesn't solve problems for anybody and creates more problems for people because now they grow up in a milieu and an environment where they are told that every obstacle they face is from some shadowy, nameless, faceless group who is out to get them simply because of the color of their skin. They'll never succeed in that environment. On the Black Lives Matter idea, I want to find the people alongside you who think Black lives don't matter. I'm still looking for those people. Really, I mean, the implication is, of course, that for a bunch of people out there, for some reason, they're fine with black people getting shot in the street for no reason. Hands Up, Don't Shoot was based on a lie. That's problematic. The idea that there is a huge number of black young men who are being shot for no reason by police officers is not statistically true. It's just not statistically true. The fact is that according to statistical studies at John Jay College, if you are a white man in a similar confrontation with police, you have a better chance of being shot by police than if you are a young black man. More white men are shot by the police every year in the country than young black men are shot by police in the country. The idea that there is a spate, and there's an easy proof. We know all of their names. We know all of their names. When there's a broad, there are 30 million black men in America. Okay, when we know all of, President Obama said that we have a spate, it's a slow rolling crisis. Once every couple of weeks, we have a case that's under dispute. So let's take his statistic. Okay, so let's say it's 26. Not one is too many, and we all agree. But is it really a slow rolling crisis with a broad trend across the nation when there are 30 million black people in the entire country? And 26 people are shot under disputed circumstances, and probably at least half of those, the cop is at least justified. In Michael Brown.